Hello, everyone. I will present to you today a truthful generalization of Black-Scholes-Merton. And I will oppose that to the most common quantitative generalizations, which I believe betray the meaning of BSM. So today, I will not concern myself with the question of whether BSM corresponds to some truth out there and whether its generalizations correspond to more complete truths or whatnot. Rather, I will turn to BSM as such and try to look into it to try to see what the element of truth is in BSM itself. And I will try in my generalization to be true to that element of truth. I am encouraged to go in this direction by this leading figure in derivative pricing and stochastic volatility modeling, Lorenzo Bergomi. I quote him from the opening pages of his book, and he says, "It may come as a surprise to many that, despite the widely publicized inconsistency between the actual dynamics of financial securities and the idealized log-normal dynamics of the BSM model, the model is still used daily in banks to risk manage derivatives books." So Lorenzo is obviously seeing a quality in Black-Scholes that he tells us should be separated from the underlying dynamics. And and he goes on to say, "The argument goes this way and not the other way around. Modeling in finance does not start with the assumption of a stochastic process for the underlying equity S, and modeling has little to do with Brownian motion." So he himself is encouraging me actually to completely disconnect the quality that he's seeing in the Black-Scholes and which justifies that everyone is choosing it, disconnect that quality from the underlying quantitative process. And that's why the subtitle of my presentation today can as well be, or a theory of qualitative finance, because what I will accomplish today is a qualitative analysis of BSM, not a quantitative analysis. And the hope is that at the end, we may end up with some qualt insights instead of quant insights. So to do that, I will reconstruct the world of BSM from its genesis until the end of that world. I will do this reconstruction qualitatively, as I have said. And of course, genesis and end of this world will have to be understood in the logical sense, not in the chronological sense. And when I do this journey of reconstruction, I will find myself at the crossroads, which hopefully will show me the way to the truthful generalization. And then when I take the direction, I hope to show you that the regime switching model will be that truthful generalization. So let me begin at the beginning, at genesis. And so at the beginning, there was the first element is bond B. At the beginning, there was B, the bond or the bank. There was only money, which could only be loaned or borrowed, and the debtor and the creditor was both locked inside the circle of debt, staring at each other and awaiting the earlier between redemption and the event of default. Then there's the second element. In 1602, the Dutch invented the joint stock company when they created the Company of East India, and there was S, the stock. And when the stock was invented, this completely changed the picture, because you no longer loaned money to the entrepreneur and went into liquidation of his assets in case he did not pay you back your money. But here you became equally shareholders with him in something called a company. And this way you both faced bankruptcy in case it should happen, or equally you both faced the potentially limitless upside. And as soon as there was S, the stock, immediately the market was created. Why? Because S, the stock, could only be volatile. Otherwise, it would be identical to B, the riskless bond. And of course, we should have two possible values, at least for S, one over S up and one down S down, which should straddle the bond. And for the quantitatively minded among you, we must have the average growth of the stock obviously exceeding the interest rate. And as a matter of fact, in history, as soon as the stock was invented by the Dutch, trading started happening of that stock in the street. And later they built a roof over the heads of the people. And this is how the stock exchange was invented. And so therefore we have here our third element, which is M for market or volatility, which of course I express as delta S, which is the difference in price of the spread between S up and S down. But I insist to confuse it also with delta times S, which is the dynamic fractional holding of the stock S. Why? Because a market, a stock market, is not just an abstract random generator of numbers of prices. It is an actual place of exchange where people exchange contracts. Therefore, the price motion is not separable from a change in size of the holding or from delta times S. And of course, this brings to mind the name of Merton, the dynamic fractional holding of the stock S. And therefore, I end up with my first qualitative equation for today, which is bond plus stock plus M market equal BSM. Now, S and M, stock and market, contract into delta S. And here you all recognize, of course, B plus delta S, which is the self-financing, the expression of the self-financing dynamic trading. And here the explanation is that now the money account B is now geared to dynamic trading. It's no longer loaned to the company. It remains in the bank. However, it's there to finance trading the stock of the company in the stock market. To cite Niall Ferguson in his book, At the Ascent of Money, we can say that company, bourse or stock market, and bank provided the triangular foundation of a new kind of economy. And I say that this is a single element now that we have constituted, a fourth element, if you will, a new quality, which I call the quality of trading. So B plus delta S to me now become also a single undivided element, which is dynamic trading, a new quality. Of course, it hasn't escaped anybody that the reason I'm using primary colors and basic shapes is that these are qualities, not quantities, in my reconstruction up to now. And as a matter of fact, I want to delay as much as I can the moment when quantity and quantification will enter in the picture. And this, in case you are wondering why I represent the triangle in yellow, the square in red, and the circle in blue, here is, you might find here some background, which we might discuss later if we have time. However, the question now becomes, how will then my perpetual qualities be quantified at some point? How will my eternal forms, which I've just created in a genesis, ever change? And the answer is that they will not change in time or in space. So they will not change quantitatively in the sense of a quantitative process or stochastic process, but they only can change through the end of time and the end of the world because they are eternal. So it's only apocalyptic events that can make change enter into my picture. And there will be two such events, one dealing with B and the other one with delta S. So the first one in 2008, what happened is that we all witnessed the end of B, the bank. The bank collapsed and it needed to be bailed out. And I call this the left end of the world because it just, this is the left end of my expression. And keep in mind that this is a credit event, which is a jump, a massive jump. I say that because later when we become quantitative, we might need to involve jump processes in the proceeding. So, but what happened since 2008 is that we invented something called bail-in. So bail-in brought the end of the world back within the structure. So the world was saved, if you will, by bail-in. And this, in this way, the structure could be perpetual again. And this is how I claim credit became quantified for the first time. Why? Because the perpetual B bank, the perpetual bank that we had in the earlier picture where everything was eternal and perpetual, is now replaced by a perpetual debt structure with a periodic early redemption option and a bail-in clause, otherwise known as the banking contingent conversion bond or the banking COCO. Now we have periodically to go check the so far formal and unquantified credit of the bank. Why? Because we have to measure extension risk now, if only at each call date, to check whether the issuer, the bank, will call back the issue or whether the bond will be extended. So now we are sensitive to extension risk. And this is, I claim, how finite and material time makes an entry into what used to be indefinite and formal time. this is how credit becomes measurable and quantifiable in my sense. Because and there now exists a binary gate at each call date. We need to check whether the credit is good or whether it's bad. So this is how stochastic credit is defined according to me and not the other way around. Now we wonder how will the right, the end of the word, how will elemental volatility delta S become quantified? So there's another massive event which happens in 1987. I'm sure you all know what I'm talking about. And of course, I'm not following chronology here. As I said, I'm only following logic. So in 1987, that's why the two dates don't follow each other necessarily in my account. In 1987, we witnessed the end of delta S, the market. As a matter of fact, the next day to the market crash of October market crash, the exchanges almost didn't open their door because the clearinghouse was almost in default. So similarly to credit, I call this a trade out. And I call this the right end of the word because this is obviously the right end of my expression. And this is a crash event, so also it will make us think about jump processes later. And so similarly to credit, what happened since then to save the world is something which I call trade-in. Trade-in brought the end of the world back within the structure. So this is how the end of the world was folded back into the world. Therefore, the structure of trading, of course, delta S, could be perpetual again. And what do I mean by trade-in in this instance? I mean simply the burst of the options market. So now I'm saying, because as a matter of fact, 87 was to my mind the date in my reconstruction where the options started being traded and when the option smiles started being emerged. And option smiles, as we all know, are due to the fact that options trade independently of each other. And why do I say that the structure can be perpetual again? That's because if options start trading as independent assets, now it means that options can be written on the option, so on and so forth, so that the structure is perpetual again. Let me expand a little bit because it may sound a little bit puzzling for you. Why does derivative trading come from the end of the world of BSM, according to me? That's because if we put ourselves back for a second in the formal world that I described earlier, in the qualitative, colorful world of the beginning, this was a situation, even according to the formalism of Black and Scholes, where we start with the stochastic process that of the underlying S, this is a situation where the stock S is the only thing trading. There is only price and no value or notion of valuation. Nobody tells us to value the stock IS. Its price process is given. And this is a situation which there is no fundamental value to guide the valuation of the stock S. And this is a situation that scares a lot of people who don't like markets and who believe in fundamental value, because here basically it's what we call Keynes beauty contest. It's a situation where the stock S is completely left to the crowd and people buy the stock not because they have voted for the most beautiful company, but because they vote for the company whom they think that other people will vote for as the most beautiful one. So this self-referentiality creates, of course, speculative bubbles and the crashes and randomness. And this is why if you take a step back, now there is no fundamental value by which to value thing, and there is only the free exchange of stock on the stock exchange. Volatility, if you take a step back and think for a moment, volatility becomes now the only fundamental value, the only new fundamental truth, from which, by the way, the value of derivatives is impeccably and as unassailably derived. And why do I say that the valuation of derivatives is then unassailable? Simply because it flows from the very criticism of value, which is price and the volatility of price. So how could it be criticized itself? That's the amazing thing, because now volatility is the only fundamental value and volatility is the criticism of the existence of a valuation, because there's only the volatility of price. Derivatives are evaluated off that. So they are unassailable. You cannot not believe in their value. And this, by the way, is why I think it gave force to the market maker to go ahead and write options and make their markets, by the way. But when I say that, because volatility is, as I said, the fundamental value that we have now, and options were the value of options were computed out of that concept of volatility, which is the concept of trading and the concept of the market. You agree with me that the value of derivatives belongs to a different level. It belongs to the conceptual level of the market. So it belongs to a different level than the object level. It is above the trading floor. So as a matter of fact, there is no way derivatives could be traded on the same level as the underlying S in this formal picture here. And as a matter of fact, there never was a stochastic process initially given for the price of the derivatives. Because as I said, the format that we were in is a format whereby to be trading is to be given a stochastic process from the start, which was the case for S, but it was never the case for derivatives. So derivatives, if you think really of what's happening here, there's no way they could be on the same level at the stock and, as the stock and trade on the same floor. And in saying this, I'm not even saying that they are not trading because they are redundant, as the most people think. They are not able to trade because they are not even existent yet. They are not even written yet. And in saying so, I'm comforted by this quotation, which I will extract from Harrison and Pliska. As you know, these two gentlemen have rigorized the Black and Scholes model in a famous paper. And in this paper, they say themselves, we have focused on a market. This is to make Black and Scholes rigorous once again. We have focused on a market where only the stock and bond are traded. And we have discovered that investors can manufacture call options for themselves in this market at the price specified in the formula. So all you can do is manufacture the payoffs of options for yourself. But it means these payoffs that you are manufacturing for themselves, you are not manufacturing for somebody else. We are still very far from creating an independent trading asset, which is the option. And by the way, they continue and they say it is customary to go further, arguing that arbitrage profits could be made if options were sold in a parallel market, to reduce verbiage and to get a self-contained mathematical theory, meaning they want really to stick with the formalism here, we shall simply stop with the statement of attainability. So here, yes, they confirm the fact that following strictly the formalism, options do not exist as independent trading assets. So that's why I come to the answer of my question, how will my volatility, the elemental volatility, become quantified? Qualitative volatility, with which I started with the colors, became quantified, according to me, for the first time, not through delta S statistics, but through our single element, B plus delta times S, or the complete self-financing dynamic trading strategy, otherwise known as the derivative premium, soon to become the derivative price. And remember, that happens to the end of the world. So according to me, there never was quantitative volatility and even less so stochastic volatility in the sense that people understand when they write stochastic processes for volatility, but immediately implied volatility. So we immediately went from my first elemental volatility, the one in the eternal form, to implied volatility. And this change is not a quantitative change, of course, it's the change in nature. So that this direct passage from elemental volatility to implied volatility opens a space of qualitative variation, not quantitative variation. If I'm telling you that volatility becomes quantified for the first time from my Platonic realm that I described at the beginning, gets quantified as implied volatility directly, it means it's a qualitative variation, not a numerical variation, because there is no variation in any parameter of a model. There is no even no mathematical theory ever which would create the option market for me if such a market is not existing yet. And this qualitative variation from elemental volatility to implied volatility will lead, hopefully, to the regime switching structure, which I'll define at the end. And in doing so, there is here a quotation which I have found, which I found was completely crucial in this regard, by Eliot Guémant. And in this quotation, I will find all the elements that I will need to construct my truthful generalization. I will find it as a prototype. And this citation, which I will show you, is the first step in this new space of variation, which I call qualitative, which I have discovered. Elliott is writing this article in 97. So the Nobel Prize for BSM has just been awarded. And there was criticism which was raised against the Nobel Prize by saying, how could they earn a Nobel Prize when the economy of Black-Scholes is not risky because volatility is constant? To which Elliott answers, no, the economy of BSM is risky by definition because it amounts to exchanging volatility. The fact that this risk should be materialized by a single little number, sigma, makes it, on the contrary, palpable and immediate for everybody. So I find this really amazing. If you really analyze closely what Elliott is saying here, she's not saying that the economy of BSM is risky because volatility will eventually become stochastic. To the contrary, she is saying it's the economy of BSM as such. So BSM, the unchanged model, which is risky by definition of the model. And as a matter of fact, the fact that the number that we are holding in our hand, the sigma, the palpable number, the fact that it's palpable, this is what's made it immediate as risk for everyone. So to be true to Black and Scholes-Merton, which is what I'm looking for from the beginning, all we need to do is really hear what Elliott is really saying. And what she's saying, she's speaking about the single little number sigma, which I interpret as being constant then, this number. So the whole amazing twist that there is in Elliott's statement, because obviously she wants to keep BSM, not change it. However, she wants to twist it somehow. So I express it in this way by saying that this constant number sigma, as she says, is ready to be exchanged, which literally means changed outside, not changed within the model. And here, if I can meditate a little bit on the smile problem, because obviously this implied volatility number, when it is exchanged, it will generate the smile problem. I say that there wouldn't be a problem if we just quantitatively matched the existing derivative prices with a stochastic volatility process, as we do usually, because this completely dissolves and resolves the tension and the twist that we know is essential in Elliott, and it erases the smile. On the contrary, I want the smile model, which fits the whatever derivatives prices, to be always ready to be recalibrated to new derivatives that do not exist yet, which I need to create and make their market. The smile problem is the persistence of the palpable exchangeable number of Elliott. We must keep the twist if we don't literally keep the BSM process. We must keep the model, I mean, the general model that we have, we'll have later closed, and the derivatives market in existence in order that we may make that market and thus keep the unsettlement, not release the unsettlement and the tension. So let me now present to you the regime switching structure and hopefully show you how this answers to what I need. So what we need, our goal is open, as I said, this new space of variation of a new type for what I call the exchange, not the quantitative change of volatility. So volatility will have to change outside the model. It changes while remaining constant, if you will, somehow, paradoxically, because it is a palpable number that will be exchanged and not changed. So the problem that we have is how to keep the single little number constant in the model while exchanging it outside the model. Better, how to generalize exactly this, because obviously later we will have to resort to other dynamics than Black-Scholes, if only to be able to fit the price of more than one option. So in that general model that we are looking at, we need to generalize the fact that this model, which obviously will have more than one volatility number, how to keep the single little numbers of that model constant while exchanging them outside the model. How, in other words, to have a model constantly looking at its outside. Answer, this will come in a new qualitative structure, and I call it qualitative as opposed to quantitative in the sense of the usual generalization of stochastic volatility, a new qualitative structure in which the level of quantitative variation is left unsettled. So we have to keep the unsettlement, as I said, and keep the tension. So here it is, qualitatively. Let me now present to you the regime switching model. At first blush, it looks absolutely like a superposition. So here it's three regimes for illustration purposes. It looks absolutely like a superposition of three Black-Scholes models in their respective worlds. So here the first one, the regime one, is a regime where volatility, the stock, and the credit are trading at mid-ranges, if you will, then the second regime is a regime where the stock went to the sky, we are flush with credit and volatility is low, and the third regime is a crash regime, if you will. Here, the stock has collapsed, blood is everywhere, volatility is huge, and the credit has been tightening. So we have Brownian diffusion of the underlying asset in each regime. As I've just shown you, we have different values of volatility and credit in each regime. And the shifting between, or the switching between regime is triggered by Poisson processes back and forth. And switching, therefore, entails a jump in volatility, in credit, and in the stock price as well. And of course, the jump parameters themselves jump as we change regimes. So to those among you who like fancy names, we can call it a discrete state stochastic jump diffusion model. And now I come to the crucial point to try to show you how this structure has the feature which will allow it to look at its own outside and always present the tension and the twist which we have recognized after Eliot's statement to be what's essential in Black-Scholes. And this crucial point will be the associativity of regime switching, which I will explain now. So let's start, for instance, by an instance which I call model A of my regime switching model. Of course, we are already a step beyond Black-Scholes because this is obviously a stochastic volatility model. So assume that we have calibrated it to the vanilla smile so far. So therefore, volatility is stochastic. So VIX is a tradable now because volatility is stochastic. However, I have not calibrated this model to options in VIX. I can now only value them of the model because their market doesn't exist yet. So now two things are going to happen. First of all, in time, I will be recalibrating my bundle the next day to the new vanilla smile. Therefore, obviously, in recalibration, the parameters of my model are going to change. So I will be switching between two regime switching models, model A and model B, while at the same time, it's most probable that the options on VIX, which are is our new generation of derivatives, have started admitting of a market and have started themselves to exhibit volatility smiles, which induced me into thinking that the volatility of volatility now needs to be stochastic, which is not the case yet in my model. So all of that means if I am switching between two model A and B that in this way, it means that the true model, if you will, the meta model is simply the superposition of the two. So it's a model A plus B, which, surprise, is still a regime switching model, of course, a six regime switching model. And now the crucial observation is that all I need to do now is that actually calibrate to the options on VIX. And chances are that I will not need the multiplications of parameters that six regime imply in order to do that. Chances are that a new three regime switching model, which maybe selects two and the sixth one of those regimes, will match for me together the new vanilla smile and the new smiles of options and on VIX. So, and the conclusion is that if we forget about the six regime, which I only used as an intermediary in my reasoning, the conclusion is that it's completely left unsettled ultimately whether the initial three regime structure was a model just of stochastic volatility or a model of stochastic volatility of volatility. It's only when I calibrated it to the smile of options on VIX that it turned into a model of stochastic volatility or volatility. So hence the idea that this model is able, depending on how I calibrated or recalibrated, to both be a constant model, if you will, in a certain sense, and be able to look at it outside in a direction which is orthogonal to the one at first, which was the quantitative direction. And add to that a very nice feature of the regime switching model, which I call the genericity of regime switching. And by that, I mean is that regime switching is a generic formula. You saw how I made volatility of volatility stochastic without even ultimately increasing the number of regimes. And this is possible because the structure is discrete. Whereas if you were talking about continuous stochastic processes, what you will have to do after writing a process for stochastic volatility is write another process for stochastic volatility or volatility. And you don't know what to do next and what to do ever. Whereas here I have the one formula which has only regimes, which I can increase forever. One other feature is its versatility. It's completely homogeneous and it's completely computably tractable. This is just an image to illustrate all of that. We will discuss it later if we have time. In conclusion, I have shown you three revolutionary modes of qualitative variation. The first mode, which may appear strange to you, is that quantification in my schema comes from the end of the world. This is how I introduced stochasticity, remember. Another mode, a new mode of qualitative variation, is the notion of exchanging volatility, not changing it. The fact that it is constant and not constant, and which is expressed by the regimes and their peculiar space of variation, which I have shown you. And the last variation to the orthodoxy is that derivatives are not redundant because volatility is stochastic, but because they do not exist. So let me now, to finish, show you how, in actual fact, the regime switching behaves, because I have promised to delay quantity as much as I can. So maybe here now is the time that I show you the quantities at last. So this is data that I have pulled from last week. We have here the full vanilla smile of the Eurostoxx from last week. We have more than 1,000 options here. And I have basically two slides that I will show you with a difference between them. So the difference is that in the first instance, I have calibrated a five regime model to all the bid and ask spreads that you see in blue here of implied vols of the vanilla, as well as I have calibrated it to the futures on these stocks here, but I have not calibrated it to the options on these stocks. You see that my model in red is not fitting the options on these stocks. It's only in the second instance, so without changing my structure, that I now calibrated to everything here. Now it's calibrated to the options on these stocks. And if you look at the numbers here of total volatility in the regimes, the difference between the first instance and the second, here you can see that in the first instance, I only had a model of stochastic volatility, because volatility is switching between these five values. Whereas here, calibrating to the options on these stocks have made the values of volatility in regime 2 and 3, as well as in regime 4 and 5, be wider, much wider apart than in the first instance. So this illustrates the fact that now volatility of volatility has become stochastic as expected. Thank you.
Hi, Ali. We do have one question, and it is, how is the regime switching model different from using a standard stochastic volatility model with long-term and short-term volatilities expressed using some factors?
Well, in essence, I mean, as I said, the regime switching model can reproduce a stochastic volatility model. However, it's more versatile, as I have said. And it has a mean reversion of volatility built in it, because the volatility states are limited to the regimes that I have. So the ultimate test is whether it will fit the same options out there in the market as a stochastic vol model. Obviously, I can tell you it performs much better, as I've shown you, because I'm able to match the full smiles of vanillas and VIX. The only difference is that it's more versatile and it's more robust. And the basic trick that I described to you is that because it's a discrete structure, it's a quality of the model not to be able to determine whether it is a model of stochastic volatility or if it's a model of stochastic volatility or volatility. So that's the main feature that I have illustrated. Okay.
Okay, and there's just one more question, and that's, during the current crisis, have you observed other examples supporting your hypothesis?
Yes, I have. I can show you, because we, in our company, we are running a daily calibration on the S&P and the Eurostoxx. Obviously, in March 2020, the values here in the regimes were much higher. So we observed the values as high as 150 in those values here. However, if you like fat tails, like my friend Nassim Taleb, you can see here something which I haven't commented, which is, as I shift between regimes in the future, this is the matrix that tells me that every time a shift happens, the stock, the underlying stock or the underlying index undergoes massive jumps. So we're looking here at jumps which might happen in the future, with a frequency of 1%, which means once every 100 years, if you will, with a jumps of minus 90% on the S&P, which is like a black swan. So typically the regimes are more powerful than any, common model in also being able to show these very massive black swan events, which obviously I did not comment today.